Hey everybody, it's a brand new Bronscast. I haven't made a podcast for a long time, and just apologize for that, but here I am, I'm back. I'm going to be doing quite a few podcasts in the next coming weeks. So I thought I'd give you an update first of all before going into today's episode. Today's episode's called Resistance is True Art. Resistance, all about the resistance. So what's happening? All the pre-production on my second album is done after 2 years of working away on that, and next week I've put my savings into a big posh studio, a huge studio in Castleford, to record the drums and the bass. And I'm really excited about that because we've got a huge wooden room to really get a great room sound for that kind of old-fashioned rock and roll drum sound, not that clicky modern overproduced sound drum sound that I'm not that keen on. So that's happening. That's a big step forward, and then after that it'll be a case of crowdfunding the album and seeing what we can afford to get on there. So the album's going to be based on the Lord of the Rings saga. Well, and so we're hoping to get choir and orchestras and flute players and Ullum pipe players and all sorts of stuff. So I'm really excited about that. Anyway, that's the update. Stay glued to the email list for more on that. And so today's episode, Resistance is True Art. This one's just off the cuff, really. I haven't done any planning for it, but a few things got me thinking. So I live in an industrial, post-industrial revolution part of the world called Yorkshire. I live in Bradford. And if you imagine Peaky Blinders, all that kind of stuff, that old Victorian mills, cobbled streets, that's the town I live in. And at one point Bradford was one of the richest cities in the world. And then, and the whole wool industry, which it's based on, fell apart, and then it's quite a deprived city to live in now. And so that's where I live. And one of the things is there's an old disused quarry up the road from me, they've turned into a park, and the trees have reclaimed all the land, and there's swans there, foxes, birds nesting, and I go up there and run through this park a couple of times a week in the mornings. And it's really quite an industrial city. It's really surprisingly beautiful and tranquil place. And quite often on my run I see this lady called Elaine. And Elaine is, I guess she's in her 60s, but she has like those kind of deep blue eyes that sort of really amazing eyes. She's got long, sort of probably previously blonde but now white hair. Quite a stunning lady for her age. And anyway, I see her every time I go up there. She's there in the morning, and she goes there to pick up rubbish. And maybe about a year ago I saw her and just thanked her. I just stopped and just said, oh, you know, thank you so much for picking up the rubbish. Obviously I know you don't have to do it, but it's a real shame up there because people literally go up there in their cars to the car park and just chuck their rubbish out the window. And she goes every day to pick up the rubbish, and she keeps her eye out for the wildlife and stuff like that. And it just struck me what an incredible act of resistance and defiance that is. It's this kind of thing. I'm not going to be beaten down by the fact that, you know, even though she picks up rubbish every day, the next time she goes there'll be more rubbish to pick up. It's a battle in a sense that she's never going to win. But there's something that really impresses me about that, because there's a life lesson in there. Because if she didn't pick up the rubbish, the place would just look worse and worse and worse. And even though she just picks up a little bit every day, it's just that act of resistance and defiance that just makes such an impact. I saw her this morning, and I chatted to her, and she's kind of funny. She always says stuff like, "Wow, you've lost like looks like you've lost about 4 stone," and you know, like you find think yourself, I don't think I was ever 4 stone fatter than I am now, like ever in my life. So she's kind of she's funny. Anyway, after I'd seen her, I ran up the top, ran the park up this really steep hill, which just about kills me. Got to the top and saw some council workers cleaning up rubbish as well, and I just went over and thanked them and said, just thank you for this act of resistance. And the council guy looked really confused, like saying, nobody's ever thanked me in my entire life for picking up rubbish. Anyway, maybe I made his day, but yeah, it's an act of resistance. It's something we should value more in life. And the reason it made such an impact is because yesterday I was trolling around Facebook, just as you do, and a friend of mine called Connor, he's just one of those guys who's he's an amazing guitar player, and he always posts just this most incredible guitar content that as a guitar player, I just love checking out what he's up to, because he posts great clips of him playing and then great clips of people playing crazy stuff from around the world. And he posted up a little thing from the BBC News. I'm just going to read it out to you. It says, orchestral musicians living on the breadline. My friend Connor says, I honestly can't think of any other job that's as highly skilled and so badly paid. And the article goes to describe how orchestral musicians who are at the top of their game basically can't afford to play in these orchestras. There's just not enough revenue, and they have to go out and take non-paying jobs and all sorts of things, you know. And my experience as a musician, it's similar. It's really hard to make a living today as a musician. And then there's a comment further down from someone says, well, unfortunately skill is irrelevant. All jobs pay based on the revenue you help generate. So let's read that again. Unfortunately, skill is irrelevant. All jobs pay based on the revenue you help generate. And I was like, what? Okay, maybe. Yeah, that's fair enough, I guess. That if, you know, that in one sense, if we live in a world where revenue has to be earned, then it doesn't matter. If people don't want the skill you have, then, you know, you're not going to make much money from it. And then further on, he goes on to say, I don't see the logic in training in a field that is beyond dead in comparison to where it was 100 years ago and so on and so forth. And I just thought, hang on a minute. What is the point in training in a field where there's no money in it? It got me really thinking. And it's funny, going to the park today and meeting Elaine again and seeing her picking up rubbish just made me think about what life is about and music, and as musicians, how do we value art and what we do, whether it's, you know, music or painting or just being creative generally. And my question is, so should they give up then, these orchestral musicians? Should they stop doing what they're doing? Should I give up because guitar is now a dying instrument and, you know, modern music is all about, you know, synthesizers and DJs and stuff like that. You know, guitar is an instrument on the decline. Well, I say that, not that you could tell from kind of the teaching scene. I'm busier teaching than ever. You know, should I give up making records? Should people give up making music or studying music because the record industry is no longer what it used to be? The fact is, you know, you're not going to get bands again like AC/DC and Bon Jovi and, you know, bands that can go on tour for 3 years straight and earn gazillions of pounds. I think those days are pretty much gone forever. You know, record sales are down, streaming's up, streaming pays badly. We all know the kind of deal with the way the industry's going. So, you know, should we give up? And I just thought, you know something, the record industry is more democratic than ever. So So it's though nobody's going to make shed loads of money like they used to in the old days, but you can make music and build a fan base now on the internet the way I've done. You can get your music out there like I do by selling it on Bandcamp in a way that's really easy. And so we've lost the quality control in one sense, because anybody could record something on their iPhone if you wanted and put it on and try and sell it on Bandcamp. But does that mean we should give up because music is now returning to the to be predominantly an amateur thing where it doesn't earn as much money as it used to? Like the big money. Is life and art only justified by how much revenue it creates? Should Elaine give up picking rubbish at the park just because she knows that it makes a small dent, really, in the scheme of things, in the overall state of our world with all the rubbish that's polluting our seas? Does one person picking up rubbish in a park near me make any difference? In a sense, it doesn't, but in a sense, to her, it makes a difference, and to me, it makes a difference. It's a form of resistance, you know? Recently, I was involved in a campaign. One of my favorite places in the world is Thirlmere, and I go up and wild camp up there. I take my hammock and my tarp and just climb up this steep hillside, get just to the top of the tree line, and it's just the most beautiful spot. You're overlooking the lake Thirlmere, and it has a couple of islands down there, and you just wake up in the morning, get your coffee, hang out of the hammock, just looking over this really big drop, and it's a beautiful space. And recently they were looking to put a zip line across it and basically commercialize the whole thing and build loads of pathways and roads and cut down some of the forest and have military trucks shipping people up there. And so my beautiful view to have zip lines crossing. Nothing against zip lines. I've been on zip wires loads of time and I love them, and I've been on them and I think they're cool. But I was just like, no man, we need to resist, because if we monetize all our natural beauty and all the natural spaces, what's the legacy? What's going to be left? And people are saying, well, it's commercial interest and we need to have, we need to earn money from these things, and so we're going to ruin the view, basically, ruin the tranquility of the place, because there seems to be this idea that commercial gain, even if it's short term, is more important. So I was like, no, resist. So we resisted. We took a petition up. I wrote to the council, to the planning committee, and was part of a movement. And in the end, it got stopped. An act of resistance. And so art and beauty, I resist this idea that they shouldn't exist unless they're providing monetary value, because sometimes the monetary value is hard to assess. Just think about cathedrals. Should we maintain these buildings that are now, arguably, you could argue that maybe they're not used as religious buildings anymore and they're falling apart. Should we maintain them or should we just let them go to ruin? Should we spend thousands of pounds keeping these buildings standing? And but then you think of all the people who tourists who go to see these places. There's a reason to go to France, there's a reason to go to Barcelona to see that Sagrada Familia Cathedral that they've been building for about 100 years. We'll still be building that cathedral when I'm an old man, perhaps after I'm gone. That building will outlive me, Is there any way of justifying it? There's architectural beauty based on the idea that things should only be done for short-term gain or things have had its day. I just think it's important to resist. So, what is resistance for me? Resistance is doing the things that make us feel alive. It's breaking the monotony. Because life is about doing things that make us connected and grounded, I think, and give us a sense of purpose. And I think there's more to life than just earning money. So for me, the reason this album, for example, has taken 2 years to write is because, honestly, the brutal truth is I go and teach guitar two, almost 3 days a week. And then I have 2 days left to do all the promotion and the writing and the videoing and the podcasting. So it's just taken a long time. But for me, every time I'm teaching, even when it's kids who don't want to learn guitar, for me, it's an act of resistance. I'm resisting this thing that's going to get me down, tell me your life, you're just a cog in a machine, and the only purpose in life is to earn money. The money that I earn through the teaching pays the bills, and also the money I earn through record sales fortunately pays the bills as well. But it's just taking me longer, so 2 years, and for me it is a fight and a struggle, but it's worth it. Because last night, for example, we had a rehearsal. And finally hearing some of this really complex music I've written for the album performed by John and Dan on the drums and bass, and hearing it all come together and hear all these ideas that are in my head being actually played and performed. Stuff I've been working on and reworking and giving up on and feeling like I've failed, and the desperation of that cycle of being an artist where you think it's brilliant, it's rubbish, I'm rubbish, I give up, it's actually quite good, it's ace, that kind of cycle. That hearing that stuff coming and all the difficulties I've had to overcome and all the busy now in rehearsal and schedules, there's something about that that makes me feel alive, and I'm creating a piece of art that is going to go out there and people, hopefully, if it's like the last record, from all over the world are going to buy. Will it earn me a shed load of money? Who knows? Will I be able to give up the teaching and only do music? That'd be awesome. That's the dream. If it fails, will I feel like it hasn't been worthwhile? You know, if the crowdfunder fails and nobody buys the album, will I feel like it's been worth it? Yes, because the last 2 years I've invested in resisting. I've developed my skills. I've expressed myself. I've learned so much. I've written music I'm really proud of. I've enjoyed the entire creative process when it's been hard and when it's been brilliant. And I think resistance is the true art in every form. So no matter what we do, and maybe you do a job that you think is boring and you're working, you have a dream of doing something creative, and you see stuff like, oh, well, orchestral musicians are on the breadline, or there's no money in the record industry anymore, or I just can't justify taking this kind of risk. Seriously, I just think we need to reframe what life is about. And I think, although I don't believe the thing of build a field and they'll come kind of thing, I think that's a bit of nonsense. It's not quite as straightforward as that. I think there is something to be gained from investing into the things that you're passionate about and the things that make you feel alive. That for me is composing and performing my own music. So, you know, whatever you do, you know, look at the people around you, like Elaine, who picks up rubbish every day of the week in this park. It might look futile, but something in there is not only she's been transformed, I'm being transformed by seeing her, the work she does. The park is still a place that is nice to be, and that's just all part of life, you know, resisting. Oh, just let me finish with one final story. One of my favourite books is a book by Russian author, now I'm not really sure how to pronounce his name. What is his name? Alexander Solzhenitsyn. I don't know how to say it, but the book is called One Day in the Life of Ivan Denisovich. And the reason I love the book, and I really recommend you read it, by the way, it's Ivan was, well, a fictional character, but he was in one of the Soviet concentration camps, in one of the gulags. And basically, it describes just the brutality of life out there. It was freezing cold. They had poor living conditions, and basically, political prisoners were sent there. People who tried to resist or did vocally resist the Soviet, the regime of Stalin, basically. And this book, on the surface, seems really dark because they have this quote that they have to make mortar, but the only way they can make walls with cement and mortar is to put it on before it freezes, and it describes all the conditions and the struggles he has to get a little bit of extra bread. And then the end of the book, I won't spoil it entirely, but like he has these little acts of resistance where he tries to hide nails and things like that to make tools so that he can escape. It's just chronicles a 24-hour period. In the end, I think he manages to hide, get past the guards. Everyone's getting lined up and they're searching them, and he manages to find a way of hiding some contraband to get back to his quarters. And it's a book about that thing, about the resistance against all odds, the hopelessness of it all. This character brings so much hope because the daily struggle, you're rooting for this guy and you're like, come on, he's like managed to get an extra scrap of bread from somewhere. He's managed to get through the day without getting discovered. He's managed to get through the day without dying, I guess. And there's real beauty and hope in the book. And really recommend you read it. And I think there's something that's true about that, where even in the worst situation, he found something to make life worthwhile, the struggle of worthwhile. Another one is This Beautiful Life, where the boy, story of a dad and his son, where they get sent to they were Jewish and got sent to concentration camp, and the dad makes this thing about with his son where he gets points, and every time he does something like hides under the bed or does something to get discovered, he gets extra points, and the end target is that his boy will win a tank. And there's all these games and a dad that tries to protect his son from the harsh realities of what was going on by making it into a game. I really recommend you watch the film. There's a real beauty to it, and I think there's truth in that. There's an act of resistance, there's an act that gives meaning. So in whatever you're doing, resist, don't give up, fight the good fight, and keep on pushing for the things that you enjoy doing. Here ends the Bronscast. If you enjoy it, please give it a share. Please sign up to the email list on my website. That's the best way for me to keep you updated. And keep your eye out for the crowdfunding campaign coming up and all the videos I'm going to be doing of the recording sessions as we go along. Thanks for listening, guys. Peace, love, and good happiness stuff.